A passage like this is a beautiful reminder that he's called us to be disciples, to learn. It's going to come up right away in the first few verses, and we want to remind ourselves that that's why we get up in the morning. That's why we do what we do here, is to make disciples, that is, to become students of Jesus, apprentices of Jesus, not just in the academic sense, but in the sense of a life that is learning a new skill, the skill of Christ-likeness. And so, I just feel really grateful to be here. This passage is going to challenge us that the church should be a place where diversity is welcome, where acceptance may not necessarily mean agreement, but acceptance is a high value, where we initiate love and welcome people in. It challenges us in a variety of ways. There is just so much division and hurt and pain in the world. This is a world where we hear about things like ISIS and Charlie Hebdo and Ferguson and every excuse that we can find to divide. And then what it does for us is it gives us just emotional prompts, cues to just hate, to hate the world, hate other people, get mad at, to focus on. And yeah, I thought it was beautiful, the follow-up cover on the Charlie Hebdo magazine had the caption, "All is forgiven." A week later, wow, that there are agents of reconciliation there. You know, and it may take generations. It may take generations. Maybe kids of kids of kids of kids of terrorists who will say, "There's a better way," and that forgiveness always wins over hatred. It just may not win immediately. But sometimes the victory is a long way off. You know, as Martin Luther King Jr. said, "I might not get there with you, but we will get there." There is a beauty in the way of Jesus that is not only calling us to a higher reality, but the way of getting there. In the meantime, until we fully experience it, the way of getting there is the way of peace, which is beautiful. When I was down in the States, I asked our class to go out to a movie together. Let's have a field trip. And I said, "Let's do American Sniper." I wanted to be patriotic while I was on their turf. They thought it would be too violent, so they wimped out. I told them they were being unpatriotic and that Jesus would judge them. But we settled for Selma, so we went, which is also a great piece of American history. It not only exposes some of the hatred and the bigotry that exists within the human heart, but it also gives us a more current example of someone following the way of Jesus to bring about change. And I'll tell you, as I know I'm a bit of a hobbyist when it comes to life and example of Martin Luther King Jr., as someone who appreciates the way of peace. And so I knew it was coming, and I knew the story, and I knew, oh, now this is when, oh, yes, this is what's going to happen. But it didn't matter that I knew emotionally, just it was a punch in the gut. I needed a good cry, I guess, because when the movie was over, they were all, "Hey, that was pretty good. That was how does Bruxy feel?" And I was over there blubbering in a corner. They had to pick me up off the ground out of a pool of, it was some kind of mixture of tears and butter, I think, that we weren't really sure what was going on down there. But it is a beautiful example of what we see Jesus doing in John chapter 4. In fact, just to give us a framework for memory, let's watch the trailer. Let's watch it again. Here it is.
He's got supporters. Detroit, New York, Los Angeles, inciting large-scale arrests and sympathy marches.
I'm very aware of that, Mr.
Hoover.
What I do know is he's nonviolent. What I need to know right now, what's Martin Luther King about to do next?
Mr. President, Dr. King is here.
Mr. President, in the South, there have been thousands of racially motivated murders.
We need your help, Dr. King. This thing's just going to have to wait.
It cannot wait.
You got one big issue, I got 101.
Summer it is.
Here is the next great battle.
Selma's the place, and they ready.
Dr. King!
I tell you, that white boy can hit.
You will not tolerate agitators attempting to orchestrate a disturbance in this state.
It is unacceptable that they use their power to keep us voiceless. Those that have gone before us say no more.
People actually say they're going to kill our children. They are trying to get inside of your head.
What happens when a man stands up, says enough is enough?
We built the path as we came, rock by rock.
His cell is probably bugged.
proudly is.
We must march. We must stand up.
You march those people into rural Alabama, it's got to be open season.
May I have a word?
There's no word to be had.
The people. The people. The people. The people. The people.
There are 70 million people watching. These pictures are going around the world.
We must make a massive demonstration.
White, black, and otherwise. Come to Selma.
I heard about the attack of innocent people. I couldn't just stand by.
Looks like an army out there.
This revolution goes on and on. This revolution goes on and on.
My eyes have seen the glory. 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 Hallelujah.
What happens when a man stands up, says enough is enough?
Oh, man. It's happening again. Okay. Wow. So there's seeds of prejudice, I think, are in all of us. There is, we are born wanting to identify with that which is familiar. And as we grow up, we can leverage that for the beauty of the family of diversity, or we can stick to our own and just continue to water the seeds of division and that which is just other. And then, of course, when the other is aggressing against you, how do you think African Americans at that time and this time would feel towards those white people who were aggressing against them? But they took the initiative to demonstrate a different way of being, which is an act of love. Love is not necessarily how you feel about somebody else. It is treating them according to the value that they you know they have as an image bearer of God. And so you don't aggress back. You initiate kindness, not hatred. And so there may be someone that comes to mind. As we look at how Jesus teaches us how to do this with the Samaritan woman in John 4, there may be a kind of person. It could be racial. It could be socioeconomic class. We love to make fun of rich people. We stereotype them. And they can stereotype the poor people. And we can. It could be a gender thing. It could be age and stage of life where we have our jokes and we have our ways of separating. It could be the kind of clothes you wear, the kind of music that you listen to, and you just think those kind of people. There are ways that we separate others. Oh, it could be a sexual orientation. It could be, goodness, try and make up for that weeping session. Went to see The Imitation Game. Speaking of sexual, we'll talk about that next week, but bigger puddle of tears, let me tell you. What amazing movie, but that's another story. We'll talk about it next week. But there are different ways that we break it down, separate ourselves from others, and those, the I don't like you-ness can come up to the surface. I get that. I understand that. But to then go away and wait for you to like a people, then you will act because you want to act genuinely, is the wrong way to go about it. Because you're keeping yourself separate from people while the stereotypes can fly back and forth and the misinformation. Love leans into life, leans into relationship, and when you choose to love in spite of how you feel, you actually then actually position yourself closer to people so that you could begin to get to know them and could begin to like them. Listen, if you don't like someone, you can at least start loving them. And as you love them, you give yourself an opportunity to learn what it means to like them too. And we see Jesus modeling this for us. Open up your Bibles to John chapter 4. We'll just look at the first few verses today of John 4, and then we're going to be moving through this over the next few weeks. You know, Jesus had said in the Acts version of his Great Commission, he says to his disciples in Acts 1:8, you know, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And that power is going to empower you for amazing things, and one of them is going to be this. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Samaria specifically highlighted, it is a region that would cause emotional discomfort for a Jew to say, we're going to take the gospel to them. And it's not the news of you are condemned before God. It is the gospel proclamation of good news that includes an invitation to come and join us, to become a member of the kingdom. When we proclaim the gospel, we are not just, or at least we shouldn't be, engaged in an exercise of feeling superior. I have truth, you live in lie. I dwell in light, you live in darkness. You're lucky I'm coming to offer this to you, which sits us in the emotional seat of judgment. But The gospel is an invitation to come and be a part of the kingdom. Jesus is Lord. Submit to him. That makes you a fellow citizen. It makes you brother and sister. And that's hard to do when you're inviting the people to come and join you that you actually don't want to hang out with. That would have been very true with Samaritans, but Jesus embeds it right in his challenge to the disciples. You're going to go and preach the gospel. That means they are going to become your brothers and sisters. Are you ready for this? This is what the kingdom life can be about. And so we see him modeling this in John chapter 4 for his disciples, which includes us who are his disciples. There are things in your notes, by the way. You have notes, you can follow along, but there are things in your notes we just won't have time to cover today. This is now the third service. I've tried twice, couldn't get through it. So there are things we're going to get to next week that we can't get to today. So if there's something you see there that we're just not covering, I'm aware of that. I should also mention that Greg Boyd just tweeted me last night that when he saw that we're covering this, that he's preaching on this very passage this morning at the very same time. And we had no knowledge of each other arriving at the same place at the same time. Now, I think it's a shame he didn't wait 1 week so we could hear the podcast and learn a thing or two. Because I think, you know, after that guy studies a bit, he'll amount to something. But it'll be great to compare notes afterwards as we are. Now, he's, I think, preaching on the whole chapter today. And we're just going to cover the first few verses. All right. Starting with the first verse of John chapter 4, we read this. We're tracking along. Now Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that he was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John. Gaining and baptizing is literally the word to make. He was making, preparing, creating. It's sometimes used to prepare a meal. Bringing the ingredients together to create something that wasn't there before. That's what Jesus was doing to disciples. He was making, creating, preparing disciples and baptizing them. He is modeling what the Great Commission is going to challenge his disciples to then go and do. So he's baptizing disciples, although in verse 2 it points out that he's not, it wasn't actually him who was doing the baptizing, but his disciples. So he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Once he heard the Pharisees found out about this, when the Pharisees heard someone was baptizing or creating a movement, as the religious kind of police of their day, they wanted to go and investigate. When John the Baptist was baptizing people, a baptism of repentance, they sent a delegation to check him out. Then Jesus was baptized by John. Holy Spirit descends. Father shares his blessing on Christ and then, you know, publicly announces, listen to him. Then Jesus moves forward from then on in the power of the Spirit. And he begins to create disciples of Jesus. And so the Pharisees are going to send a delegation to figure out what's going on here. And Jesus avoids it. This is interesting. It just reminds us of something that can explain a whole area of Scripture in the Gospels. And that is sometimes you come across stories where Jesus tells people to go and tell others about who he is. Shout it from their rooftops. He'll heal someone. He'll say, go to the temple, make a sacrifice, let the priest know what's happened here today. Then other times he'll heal someone and he will say, don't tell anybody. Or someone will say, I know who you are, you're the Messiah. And he'll say, great, keep it to yourself. There's even times when in Mark's gospel he will deliver someone of demons and the demons will say, we know you are the Son of God. And he'll say, I command you to be quiet, don't tell anybody, and away you go. Why does sometimes he let out the information of who he is and sometimes he holds back? It's what theologians call the messianic secret. The messianic secret is just a code phrase to remind us that Jesus is stewarding out his time with the disciples. Once he fully discloses his agenda to become the final sacrifice, it means the end of what is currently being touted as God's way of finding forgiveness. When he becomes the final sacrifice, when he shuts it all down, he becomes public enemy number one to the religious conservatives of his day, and that will lead very quickly to his death, one way or another. They will see to it. And so he holds back as he moves forward. Just enough, he parses it out, just enough to allow people to know who he is, but without going so public that his life ends too quickly, so he can have enough time to pour into his disciples. In just a couple short years, he's going to be gone, and they are going to have the keys to the kingdom. They are the ones who are going to steward his message and write it down for us. And so he needs to spend time with them and mentor them. And so sometimes he says, I will avoid. We don't want to bring this to a head yet. And then when it gets near the end of his life, he says, all right, I've spent enough time discipling them. And I've really come to die. And he goes straight to Jerusalem. And he lets it all out. And he knows where this is going to end in the cross. So here he avoids talking to the Pharisees, and he has to go back from Judea, which is down south, up to Galilee, which is up north, and Samaria is right in the middle. So it says in verse 4, he had to go through Samaria. Well, that makes sense. Geographically, you would say you have to go through Samaria. That's how you get to Galilee up north. But here's the thing. We do read that certain of the more pious or Orthodox Jews at the time would make a point of avoiding Samaria. They would go over to the other side of the Jordan River and go up the Jordan River and then re-enter Galilee up there. Why? Because the Samaritans were even worse than just regular Gentiles. So they would prefer to travel through Gentile territory than Samaritan territory. Samaritans were they were both ethnic and theological half-breeds. They had intermarried with the Assyrians generations before, centuries before, and so they were ethnic half-breeds, but then they had also allowed their religion to become a kind of syncretistic between Judaism and something else. So they, instead of worshiping at the Jerusalem temple, they built their own temple on Mount Gerizim, and they only interpreted the scriptures a certain particular way, and they were considered themselves God's chosen people, but they were separate completely and evolved in some interesting syncretistic beliefs. Now, at the same time, we don't blame all of them for that. They tried, we learn in Ezra and Nehemiah that when the Jews tried to rebuild the temple after coming back from captivity, the Jerusalem temple, the Samaritans offered their help and the Jews refused their help because, hey, you guys are impure. You're not. So the animosity on both sides was huge. You know, so much so that we learn from Josephus that the Samaritans at one point sent a covert ops, a black ops troop with a sack of human bones into Jerusalem, and they made it all the way into the temple in the middle of the night, and they scattered human bones around the courtyard of the temple, which would make it ceremonially unclean for worship, just to make their point. And the Jews responded by sending an army to completely destroy their temple of worship on Mount Gerizim. I mean, both sides could tell their stories to their kids and their kids' kids about the pain and the hurt and the horror. These are people who you just would think there's no way they can get along. So those who would even go through Jerusalem would pack enough food, or sorry, go through Samaria to get to Galilee, would pack their own food so they didn't have to eat any of their food. They didn't have to stop and talk to people. But usually the Orthodox would tend to go around. So Jesus, it says, he had to go through Samaria. He didn't have to go through Samaria, but he had to go through Samaria. You know what I'm saying? It's as though the Holy Spirit is saying, this is the way. This, and he is saying, I want to mentor my disciples in what it means to live this life of loving that which is other, because we're all together made in the image of God. So he had to go through Samaria, says verse 4. He came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus was tired, and so he sat down from his journey, and it was around noon. Jesus was tired. John is really clear that Jesus is God come to us. Now, he's the gospel that starts with, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh. And his cues to helping us understand that Jesus is God are laced throughout the gospel. And at the end of the gospel, you have Thomas falling down in front of him saying, my Lord and my God. And Jesus doesn't rebuke him. He receives this worship and this acknowledgement. John is clear from start to finish, Jesus is God. Here we have God getting tired. Here we have God being thirsty. Just being weary and worn out. How's that happen? He's making it very clear that when Jesus gave up his divine rights and privileges, according to Philippians 2, when he emptied himself and he became human, he was operating in the power of the Holy Spirit, but he was really human. He was the personhood of God, become human. We have both natures meeting there. And we have then the one who can fully understand what it means to live the human life. When we pray to God, he knows what it's like to be there, to be a part of our lives. And so as God in the flesh, he can show us what God is like. But he also shows us what true humanity is like. It should be like perfected humanity. He's showing us what our goal is. He's showing us what humanity, the course that humanity should be taking, the way we should be loving. Not just how God loves, but then how we should love. So Jesus was tired, and it was about noon. And when the Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus says to her, he doesn't look the other way, he doesn't say, well, we got our own supplies. He says to her, would you give me a drink? He initiates the conversation. And he initiates it from a place of weakness and vulnerability. He's going to get to the point of telling her, I have living water for you. But that's not his starting point. I bring the truth into the situation. Listen to me, which can be an assertion of power. Well, if anyone could assert power, it would be Jesus. When we assert power, it's just ugly. But even Jesus, modeling for his disciples, he initiates. And obviously, he told them about all of this, even though they weren't there. John was able to write about it. So he's living it out. And he initiates from weakness and vulnerability. He comes alongside her in his humanity as he is about to also tell her about who he truly is. It's a beautiful and gentle approach to someone else, someone who would be skeptical of what kind of treatment she would receive from a Jewish man. Could I have a glass of water? It says in verse 8, the disciples had gone into town to buy food. What? To buy food? That's not traditional. They should have packed their own kosher food so they didn't have to eat the food of the Gentiles. But Jesus said, no, we're going to be there and we're going to really be there. And you're going to go buy their food. You're going to bring it back. He's teaching them a new way of looking at human beings, a new way of crossing the line in the name of this kingdom of embrace. Verse 9, the Samaritan woman said to him, you are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans. The translation there, the NAV, has it as a footnote. The Greek translation literally says, for Jews do not use the same utensils as Samaritans. We can't have table fellowship. We can't use utensils. The guys went to town. They took your gear. You're asking me for a drink. Not only are you talking to me, which you shouldn't be, but you're going to have to take a drink from what I'm using to draw water. Jews don't do that. That makes you ceremonially unclean. If you touch a thing that an unclean person has touched, you get their unclean. It's like religious cooties. And she knows this. She says, we get judged like this all the time, that we're just by nature, just because we touch something, we make it unclean. That judgment is cast on us all the time. You can't drink from what I'm about to... Her stereotypes are being blown away of the judgment she's expecting to receive. It's just not coming. Jesus is going to point out that he knows her sin, and he knows that her theology is not right. He's not compromising. He's not saying we can all be one because basically we all believe the same thing. As we move forward in the series, you'll see that he's happy to point out where she's wrong about things. But the tone of judgment, the condemnation, is just absent from this discussion. And so he says to her here in verse 10, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. If you knew the gift of God, it's a gift. You see, what is this thing that's causing me to poke through our religious barriers and break down the walls? It's grace. It's the gift of God. If you knew the gift of God, not the alternate way of working your way to heaven, not a different religion, but just the gift of God. It's just a gift that makes this kind of fellowship, this kind of unity possible. It's God's grace to all of us. He said, if you knew the gift of God, then you'd ask me, I'd give you that living water. And he's priming her to ask another question. There's going to be more conversation. We'll pick it up next week. I love that Jesus started out this whole passage John started out by declaring Jesus was just making disciples, and this becomes part of that discipleship process with his original 12. He's training them, and he's still training us today. He's training us through the Holy Spirit that is in us. He's training us by his example that's been written down, and he's training us through the body of Christ, through brothers and sisters who can mentor us and challenge us and encourage us. All three ways he's helping us become the disciples he wants us to be. We said in our Frosh series back in the fall, that's why the Meeting House exists. Right? The Meeting House exists to make disciples of Jesus. That's it for us. The Meeting House exists to make disciples of Jesus. Our goal is not to attract seat fillers, but to train difference makers. It's not just about having a bunch of people come to hear a lecture. It is actually about us engaging with one another to say, how can we help one another take the next step together? Let me share a couple of thoughts in conclusion. Oh man, maybe we have time for one question. Anyone have a question? You want to shoot your hand up? And I'll share a concluding thought. We'll be on our way. Anyone have a question for Q&A? Come on now, don't be shy. Oakville, represent. Boom. You know, does anyone send in a text question maybe? Is there a text? Okay, good. Stanley writes in. Does God becoming flesh in the person of Jesus, he was tired, thirsty, hungry, mean that Jesus could have made errors. Doesn't to be human automatically mean to make errors and mistakes? Thanks, Stanley. Yes and no. It wasn't automatic for Adam and Eve, being perfectly human, to make mistakes. Because a human being made in the image of God without any other influence in the image of God is inclined toward righteousness, is inclined toward making good decisions. Made in the image of God. We're made like God. So we are inclined toward love. That's why temptation in the garden has to come from an external source. It comes through the serpent. Now, since the fall, we have the role of the serpent can be played by Bruxy Cavey in my life and by you in your life. Satan can tempt, but I don't need him to tempt. If I'm just left with myself, I still have a fallen nature that can tempt. So you might say to be human is to always screw up. We say, well, that has been our experience. But Jesus is called the second Adam. He is God without, he is God coming in human form without a sin nature. And like in the garden, Adam and Eve are tempted by an external source. What's the first thing after Jesus' baptism? What happens to him? He's led by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness. Why? To be tempted. That serpent tries all over again, but Jesus resists, says no. And so he's actually showing us what humanity could be. Without a distracting sin nature, without ongoing propensity towards evil. His propensity is towards good. He's the second Adam. And one day, we'll be fully purified like that. In the meantime, we may not fully get there, but in the meantime, that is the road we are to be walking, partnering with what the Spirit is doing in us. Because if you're following Jesus, you're not ultimately defined by your past, you're defined by your future. Who am I becoming? That perfected version of myself. I'm not there yet, but I walk in light of that. I move towards that. That's where His Spirit is moving us. It's a great question. Thank you, Stanley. Well, look, let me give you some homework. There's three homework pieces of homework listed in your notes. We're only going to touch on one or two. We'll save another one till next week. This idea of making disciples, making apprentices of Jesus, is a matter of, as we've said before, training, not trying. Trying is approaching something every so often, see if you can do it. Can I play the piano? No. Can I try? Yes, it would sound terrible. But I could say, well, this week it sounds terrible. I'll try again next Sunday and see if I'm any better. Still sound terrible. I'll try a third week and a third week, and I can keep trying the rest of my life. I'll never get better. What would training be like? Training would mean I can't sit down and actually play a song. I can't play Chopin. I can't play Beethoven. I can't, but I can start with scales, right? I can start with learning the basics. It says, what's just the next step for me right now? What's the next step for me? I know where I want to be, but what's the next step now? Training is incrementally doing what you can do now, so one day you'll be able to do what you can't do now. In order to do what you can't do now, you start doing what you can do now. You're working in that direction. It's the way of discipleship. It's not just saying, look, go and you'll be like Jesus. Ready? We'll pray for you, zap you with the Spirit, go. It's actually saying, what are the practices I need to implement in my life now? So that I am moving in that direction. Here's your homework assignment. Homework assignment, number one. Find someone to initiate love toward before sundown today. Stop there for a second. Find someone for you to initiate, like Jesus, to initiate love toward before sundown today. See, originally I was going to say, find someone this week to, but you know what? When we say do it this week, what does that mean? I'll start tomorrow. What happens tomorrow when you wake up? You forgot. It's like me and exercise. Perfect. I know how it works. Right? So you know it and I know it. So discipleship means immediate implementation. See, I'm going to take a baby step right now. So it could be as soon as we dismiss today. If it gets to over lunch, it could be. If it gets to dinner time and you still haven't, get nervous and quickly call somebody you need to forgive. Write that email, do, because you're going to just let it pass. And when you've finally done it for a day, it'll be easier tomorrow to remember to do it again. So initiate love with someone today before sundown, and all the better if they are different to you and are apparently alone in life. Then tomorrow, try it again. See how many days you can remember to keep at it. See how long goes this week. Talk about it in home church. Some of you will forget 10 minutes after we dismiss. Some of you will make it through a day or two. This, and then home church can be there to help remind you, hey, how you doing? Then we've got our huddles to call each other up and to just to remind, that's the training of discipleship. Instead of just showing up on Sunday like it's a class at university, that's just the trying. It's not the training. That's not discipleship. We'll skip number two for next week, and so then number three just ties in with this, which is if you're not in a home church, talk to your pastor today about joining. Let's turn the chairs to face one another. Invite one another into our lives. We can do this together with the help of the Holy Spirit on the inside. Jesus' example is laid out in Scripture and the body of Christ around us. But that body of Christ needs to be around us, not just sitting in the same room, but engaged in our life. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the challenge of Jesus. Thank you for the hope that Jesus gives us, knowing that as we follow him as his disciples, he will lead us into areas that will be maybe uncomfortable or challenging, but ultimately healing for humanity. I thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit that you have promised, which will prepare us for inviting the Samaritans in our lives into the kingdom, whoever they may be. Heavenly Father, I also thank you for the body of Christ, for the church. I thank you for this church. And I praise you. I give you glory for the beauty that you have revealed through your body. We are far from perfect, we understand that, but there is just so much good, there's so much grace that as receivers of that, we have to offer others. And I thank you that I get to be a part of this beautiful body of believers. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.